What's up, Chicky? How you doing, bro?
Just got back from the gym. Pretty tired. Waiting for Brogue to get out of game. I actually wanted to listen to some classical music right now, so I think you're just gonna have to deal with it, man. I know it's not your thing. Yeah, man, absolutely. Join Brogue and I. Hop on to NA. I'm doing well. What's up, Atira? How are you doing? It's a very cute cat hello there. Yeah, I'm pretty tired right now. I didn't even get to work out today. I was training my guys, one girl, but so I was holding the mitts for them the whole time and overseeing their workout. The head trainer asked me to take over today because he wasn't able to make it, but still just moving around holding the mitts. I ended up getting a little workout myself. My feet are freaking sore from moving around so much, but anyway, not too tired to practice, so let's do it. I'm gonna put on some chill classical music. I'm thinking I want to listen to the Liszt Hungarian Rhapsodies. Kind of in the mood for Prokofiev though. Maybe we'll start with Liszt and then maybe we'll move on to Prokofiev. Let me know if the music is too loud or if my voice is too low. Right, is that better? I can barely hear it now, but as long as it's not too loud on stream. Need to turn it up a little bit because I can barely hear it. Put it up a bit. All right, is that good? Right, sweet. Thank you. Wait, why are they doing the Team Liquid map contest now if the new season with new maps is already underway? Well, anyway, let's start hitting the new maps here. These two always have the most epic games. Brogue versus Jiggy is basically the new Frame Show versus Dust. These guys have a close game every time. Yay, games. So how are you doing tonight, Atira? Talk to me. I think it's just you and me in the chat right now. I never get viewers at night because like almost all of my viewership is from Europe. Probably like 75% of it is from Europe. It's a fast SCV scout. I think it was like a 17 scout. Speed again. Full-time viewer for a while. Dang. What's going on with that? Does the area where you live just not get good service, or what? Like, what's the deal? Is it just your provider doing a trash job, or what? Oh wow, okay, Marine first. He missed it? I think, yeah, the Overlord can actually park here, pretty sure. Second Marine. It's looking like there's gonna be a factory after this, by the way, because of the fact that there's no second barracks yet. Oh wow, the Overlord couldn't hang over this? Okay, it's over this. I thought for sure the Overlord could go over this, apparently not. Buddy made me play some co-op this morning, but I just can't get into it. Yeah, like, I don't know. Co-op is fun every now and then. I can't play more than, like, one in a row. I'll play one, it's like, yeah, that's kind of cool. But playing against the AI in RTS games is usually not a very stimulating experience. The difficulty aspect usually just comes from being overwhelmed by numbers, more so than having to make difficult decisions or something, if that makes any sense. But I will say, though, the campaign is pretty darn fun. I don't know why co-op is less fun for me. Frost, what's up? How are you doing, bro? If you stick around, I'll play a mech game for you. Just don't tell Jiggy. Oh man, really nice pickoff there from Brogue. Losing that mule. That mule was super fresh. Fresh as that prince from Bel Air. It was the fresh prince of, I guess the Will Smith of mules right there that was just killed. I don't think Jiggy has enough Marines here. Okay, it looks like just barely. If Brogue would have forced the issue, he definitely would have killed a few more Marines. Not sure he would have gotten all of them. One or two World War Ones. Yeah, for sure. Yeah, if you want to join us, it's me, Brogue, and Jiggy. So yeah, absolutely. If you want to hop on NA, we'll get you in on this. We'll put you in first. So Jiggy is M3 on EU. And Brogue is D1 Zerg here on NA. And of course, yeah, I'll play as well. So yeah, hop on NA right now. As soon as this game's over, we'll add you to the party if you want. Alright. I was gonna say drone count is pretty low right now, but he is going for a big round of drones. Okay, you got SC2 on, sweet. Alright, we'll get you right after this game. Thank you. mind drop. You don't see this every day at TBZ. It used to be pretty common. Double Evo. I don't think there are any engineering bays yet for Jiggy. So upgrade advantage for a little while anyway. Will belong to Rogue. And it looks like we're going to see a 3 Rex off of 2 base here. So Jiggy's going to put on some pressure. Thanks for the host, Latira. I appreciate it. Good job by Broke here, getting vision of these drops, responding quickly as well. Jiggy's gonna have to pick up and get out. Quick response there too. I think neither player has lost much so far. Broke should be looking to take his fourth pretty soon now. And I'm assuming he'll take it here. Wouldn't make too much sense to go all the way up here. Yeah, right after this game, man. Hydroden about to finish up. 1-1. Does Jiggy still not have... Okay, they're there. He does have his e-base, but he's not upgrading anything just yet. That could be a problem, because this is a really big upgrade window that Rogue is going to have. He's over halfway done with his 1-1, and Jiggy still hasn't started his, so I'm a little bit worried for him now. Good job by Broke. Nice awareness. Good job by Jiggy as well. Both these guys are playing pretty well right now. Good job by Jiggy to pick it up, save that mine. Nice tech scan. Unfortunately for him, he misses the lair and the Hydralisk then. What's up, Brazil made nuts? Problem that I see right now for Jiggy is the fact that he went with a 3 racks opener. Well, I mean, 3 racks off of 2 bases, but hasn't been able to do any real damage, nor has he cleared a significant amount of creep. A little bit down here, but not that much. So his third base is late. With that being said, Brogue's fourth base is maybe a little bit later than it could be, but I think that's just because he went for Hydra's, the Hydralisk Den, and actually making a few Hydras, as well as the Hydra upgrade, muscular augments upgrade before the fourth base. So, don't really blame him for doing that. That's the safer way to go about it. See word from Atira that Synth was on. Oh, yeah? Thanks, Atira, for spreading the word. And thank you, Brazil, for showing up. Appreciate it. Yeah, it's going to be a practice session tonight. Did my laddering during the day. Got my main account back into Master 2 on EU. Have to get it on NA now. NA is always harder for me. Good job there. Oh, I actually don't think he needed to cancel that at all. Bit of a misstep by Bro. But he did a good job denying mining here on the third. So these guys are trading blows at the moment. This will be my last stop before the big move. What big move? This is a rather frightening army, now that I look at it. 76 army supply to 48, and as I pointed out before, there's going to be a rather significant upgrade advantage for Brogue. Right now they're even, but his 2-2 is coming up on about 3/4 completion before the 2-2 of Jiggy starts. So usually you're just defensive with Lingbane Hydra. It's not great to attack off of creep with it, but I mean, theoretically, if he were to push at 2-2, he could possibly put the game away. There's only one tank here. I don't even know where the second one is, actually. But no clue where the second tank is. Canada 10 times better than USA. Oh my goodness. I can't even take that seriously enough to respond. Of course it is. Of course it's just as good as the USA or better. Of course it is. I've never actually been to Canada. I've seen it. I've seen it from across Niagara Falls. I've never been there. I hear it's beautiful. I mean, I hear the landscape in particular is beautiful. I've also heard that Toronto is a beautiful city. Hey, what's up, Flipster? No, this isn't a replay. This is live. We're doing a practice session. We're just mixing everybody in. So it's Brogue, Jiggy, me, and Frost is going to join us. Oh, you're moving into your new apartment? Oh, that's right. I remember you telling me about that. Congratulations again, man. That's great. Does Canada do that weird thing with the price of the tax out? The USA does that, which is really stupid and annoying. We do a lot of things well here in the United States of America, but one of those things is not putting the price of things, including tax. I do know why we do that. It's so the price appears lower. It's a marketing ploy, I guess. But yeah, it's pretty dumb. Some places will include tax in the price. It's very rare that you see that, though. It wasn't 10, it was 18. Oh, 18. I'm looking at it from far away. Yeah, I had to lean in and look closer because my laptop is really small. And it's like, as I've said before, it's at the back corner of my desk, so. All right, wow, Brogue is really threatening here. I mean, he's at max supply, so actually attacking right now is a very good idea. So he can trade off some hits and get his high pick and stuff, which is going to be ultra risk. And Jiggy just doesn't have the numbers. Like I was pointing out before, he didn't do any damage with his opener, three racks on the two bases. And he had a really low tank count, so there's pretty much no way to hold this. See. Toronto's is too big, nothing impressive, really. No different than any metropolis city. I'm sorry, I don't understand your second question, Flipster. Where, if from DOD? Go to Universal Island Adventure. Oh, heck yeah, man. That sounds awesome. I've been to... Blue player was picked wrong way. I've been to Universal Studios in Orlando, and that was freaking awesome. Oh, I'm from Pittsburgh, so southwestern Pennsylvania. How about you, Flipster? Well, basically, I'm about... It's like a 5.5 hour drive from New York City. Fracture and Parasite. Yeah, I'm starting to get a bit more split on Fracture. Fracture, I guess we'll do Parasite. From Canada, but living in Minneapolis. Very cool. Orlando was like, Highway 192 represent. Actually, I've never been to Minneapolis. I've only driven through, it's like the southern part of Minnesota. I've never properly been to Minnesota. Steel City, heck yeah, man. Steel City, City of Bridges, or the sometimes referred to as the Iron City as well. Yeah, Pittsburgh's pretty awesome, I have to say. It has its problems with specifically traffic here is horrible for how small the city is. There are only, I think, 350,000 people here. But it's an old city by American standards, and it wasn't designed to have this many people. So you get bottlenecked in a lot of places around the city, like a lot of the major highways. There's too much traffic for the amount of major roadways that we have. And the city is very poorly laid out. But besides that, the people here are generally pretty friendly. And it's a very inexpensive place to live. Synth loves his ball. Yeah, that's right. Oh yeah, I'm. Yeah, Brazil knows me well. Yeah, so I bought. Well, I guess technically, I think I'm retired now. I'm 99% sure I'm not gonna fight again. But yeah, so I love MMA and boxing in particular. I like other sports too. You know, I enjoy watching hockey. I enjoy watching hockey. I played baseball for a long time. But I'm mostly interested in combat sports because I wrestled for 10 years, beginning at age 7, and then got into Muay Thai and then boxing. And I fought, was it, 2 years ago, 2 years ago, fought in the Golden Gloves tournament. But so now I train boxers. My trainer asked me to help him out, so now I'm the assistant trainer for our team. So yeah, anything dealing with like combat sports, I absolutely love. But how about you, man? Oh, heck yeah, Pacquiao is a fantastic fighter. He's you know, he's obviously over the hill now. His footwork, and I would say even his knockout power, strangely enough, is not what it used to be. Could just be because he's moved up in weight so much over the years, and his power didn't carry all the way through. For a long time it did, but doesn't seem to be the case anymore. But like I said, his feet are definitely slower now. But he's a heck of a fighter. I really like him. How about you? Which sports do you like? Number one memory from Fight Night, my boy, is Manny Pacquiao. It's from the game. Oh, no way. Your parents are Filipino? That's really cool. Yeah, Pacquiao is an amazing fighter. Seems like a really good guy as well. So I am a big fan of Mayweather as a boxer. Obviously, outside of the ring, the guy has done some pretty horrible stuff. But I was rooting for Pacquiao in that fight. I knew it was going to be a really hard fight for him. If it would have happened 5 years earlier, I do think Pacquiao could have won, very well could have won. But when he fought Mayweather, he already wasn't quite the same fighter. Like I said, just a bit slower, not quite as aggressive. He hesitated a lot on the outside against Mayweather, which like Pacquiao from 5 years, like I said, 5 years prior to that fight, I think would have been a lot more aggressive. But yeah, definitely a big Pacquiao fan for sure. The Philippines have produced a lot of good fighters. Obviously Pacquiao, but also Nonito Donaire was another very, very good fighter. He's still good now. I don't think he retired yet. He's well past his prime and he's had a few really bad losses, but for a while he was one of the top pound for pound fighters. them transferring right now, but I didn't see what was happening with them. Imagine us going to get smashed in half. Mech is good in this map. I actually haven't seen too many games in this map. I've only played a handful. I have it vetoed for now. There are too many bases and the map is too big for me to play bio comfortably here. I don't know. The thing is, I want to see how pros play it first to get an idea of how I could play it. I'm not a big fan. It's not that I think it's a bad map, I just don't think it's good for the way that I play, so we'll see though. Brode is actually not very far ahead in supply at all. I don't think he should be attacking here. I understand he probably wants to pick off some of these expensive mech units, but he needs to hit max before he does anything. Alright, he's getting Vipers. Looks like Frost is getting ready to take his fourth base. I don't think Bile can reach this far. It's actually something that I would like to see. If the Ravagers are right here, I don't think they can hit this gas. If they're here, I wonder if they can hit the mineral line. This is just practice right now, Flipster. Just the four of us getting some practice in. We did have a clan war earlier today. I lost to 5100 EU Terran. Kind of sucked. I got caught out of position pretty badly. But our clan won. And I laddered a bit on stream as well. So, like, nighttime is usually practice sessions for me. I very, very rarely will play ladder at night. Because I don't play as well at night. I play my best, like, in the morning and during the day. I feel fresher. But anyway. I think the Vipers are probably going to do the trick here. Like, look at all those blinding clouds. Oh my goodness. The Thor is still bugged. I don't know why they never fixed that death animation. Yeah, the blinding clouds there were crucial. So, good cleanup by Brogue. We see he's got a nice lead in the resources lost department. He should have enough to come in here and do some counterattack damage. I'd actually like to see him add a bunch of lings, to be honest. I don't even know if he has speed, though. Yeah, okay, he does. Because I knew he opened up with roaches pretty quickly. Still need to invite you? I told the clan leader today he hasn't responded to me yet, but I'll ping him and remind him tomorrow, by the way. So yeah, I haven't forgotten about that. I'll give him a day to respond. I don't think this should work. Brogue needs to use the Vipers. Frost doing a good job defending this thus far. He is going to lose some SCVs, or he should lose some SCVs. There aren't enough ground units here to contest this, but these Vipers need to get to work. They should have gotten to work already, for example, abducting or throwing down blinding clouds on those tanks. Brogue needs to be careful not to lose these to Vikings now. It looks like most of the Vikings are cleaned up. One remains here. There's the abduct, but there really isn't anything to kill it. Two roaches. I think the tank wins this, right? It's gonna be close. Oh, looks like the roach might just barely win. Two and a half year old daughters, that's why I'm watching the... Are you serious? Oh my goodness. You know she could only get, who was it? Juvenile, who said, she get it from her mama. She couldn't have come up with that idea on her own, so you need to explain yourself, Fatira. What have you been telling her? Dude, look at that funky dance this boy's doing. Dropping it like it's hot. Oh yeah, he's doing the crip walk now. Alright, he's done. He's done. Bravo. She's a good learner. Yeah. Why are you watching the bad guys? Hey, maybe she was referring to me. I'm one of the bad guys. In which case, I really have to ask you what you've been telling her. So yeah, Frost is not out of the game. He's got a fifth base. Not yet mining, but I think this map is going to be pretty hard to attack, regardless of the race. Bad to the Bone. That's a great song, man. Oh my goodness, I can't think of the guy's name right now. It's George Thorogood. George Thorogood. Great freaking song. He has a few other good songs. I can't think of the names off the top of my head. Who Do You Love? That's another one. And there's one more. I just can't think of it right now. Anyway, Brogue's going to press in here. He's going to run into another planetary. I guess theoretically he could just cut up this way. Frost has got to pull everything back into position. A lot of his army is out of position at the moment. If Brogue chooses, he can focus down this planetary portion. It looks like he wants to take the army. Instead, a lot of locusts are cast, but almost all of them are actually fighting for the planetary fortress. If he would have hit the tanks, would have been big trouble for Frost. So Brogue actually lost a lot of units there. A lot of units. Yeah, he got the base, and I think he killed the other CC. I'm not sure if it was canceled or if it was killed. Unless that's it. But either way, so he did kill this base, for sure. But if he would have cast the Locust on all of those tanks, I think he actually may have been able to put the game away. As it was, he got a base, but lost a heck of a lot of army. Fortunately for him, he had and still has a good bank. But it looks like Frost doesn't want to give him the luxury of pumping out more units and getting up to max supply again. Spire transition is about to begin. I think Spire could be pretty strong against this. Pretty tank-heavy army. I mean, there are a couple of Ravens and a handful of Vikings. But Corruptors should deal with that pretty quickly. Maybe even sprinkle in some Mutas and all of the tanks would be on a timer. Good job by Frost here to bait out the Locusts. Cuddling my Protoss plushie at the moment. That's great. Sun loves it when I make Thors. Reminds me of Transformers. Yeah, they really are. They really are like Transformers. Be cool if those Thors actually killed things. No, I'm just kidding. Thors aren't as bad as they used to be. They're actually okay now. They died as Zerg, so take that for what it's worth. Pretty darn good against some areas. Anyway, Frost is in a nice position here. I think if he just pokes forward a little more, he can start attacking this gas. This is a very, very powerful position. There are a lot of Ravagers. They're going to cast a lot of Vials, but it doesn't look like any of them are landing well. So yeah, Brogue is losing a lot of resources here. The Locusts do clean up some of those tanks around the backside. These tanks are locked in. So I think Frost is just going to look to get as much value as he can with them at the moment. Couple more tanks do fall, as well as one Raven. But yeah, if Brogue wants, he should be able to head this off here, keep half of his army over here, and pretty much ensure that he kills all of these. But the question is, what is he going to do for it? Once again, I really would like to see Brogue actually go with just a gigantic wave of Zerglings, especially if they have adrenal glands. I don't think they have it just yet. But I do think a massive wave of Zerglings would do very well against these tanks. Anyway, good job by Frost to pull back. He's kiting these Corruptors quite well. The Vikings do have a 2-upgrade advantage. More Vikings join the fray. I think only one went down to that Spore Crawler. So Frost is doing a good job with, I would say, a relatively weak economy. I mean, he's mining from here. This base is still somewhat fresh, but this one is getting low. This one is getting low. This one is essentially mined out, and he's not yet mining from here. So it's more or less a 2-base economy, but I guess 3-base with the gas. Anyway, Locusts are coming in. A few more tanks do fall, but Frost may have done it. Yeah, Brogue's actually going to tap out here. That was a really good back-and-forth game. Could have gone either way for sure. I think the turning point was when Brogue sacrificed about 3/4 of his army to take out the 5th base of Frost instead of casting the Locusts on the tanks. Good job by Frost to come back into that game. To beat Brogue, I just need to play mech. I veto this map, Cerulean Fall, but whatever. I guess we can play it. maybe the other guys don't veto it. It's either that or a dream catcher. Wow, Tears don't even sub here. You vetoed Cerulean? Yeah, I vetoed it too. I think it's going to be almost impossible to win TVZ on that map. It's just too freaking big. Stupid question. How to counter a cannon rush? If you can kill the probe, or you know, if they do it with two probes, if you can kill the probes, that's the first thing to realize. Then you basically wear the rush is over. So keep that in mind. Bunker Marauder. Yeah. So just keep in mind. If you can get a probe, that's always first priority, but you don't want to lose your units to get the probe. So, the reason why I'm saying that is because you kind of have two choices. Open with Reaper, or you open with Marine. If you open with Marine, you're just going to build a bunker, and then you're going to bring SCVs to repair the bunker as it's being attacked, and you're going to get, like Jiggy said, you can go for Marauders, put them in the bunker, or go for a tank. As soon as your tank is out, the rush is over, and it's just a question of how much economic damage you took. But if you go with a Reaper, you can usually have a chance to kill the probe before the cannon rush gets really big. I will say this, if you are able to get a proxy factory while they're cannon rushing you, you can do huge damage. I support Symphonic morally. Yeah, thank you very much, Atira. So, if you're playing TVP in the first place, you should be SCV scouting at like 17 or 18. So your SCV that's on the other side of the map, when they're cannon rushing you, if you build a proxy factory with that and you make a cyclone, like you know how like I like to do the proxy factory float into the base? If you make a cyclone on the other side of the map, you can destroy them. It's a chaotic situation, Flipster. It's very chaotic, so you know, so like, I guess, like, don't feel too bad if you struggle against it. There are different ways that you can deal with it. But, like, another way, what I like to do is let the Protoss overcommit to making the cannons. It depends on the map, because it doesn't always work. Let them overcommit to making cannons and pylons and packing up everything and floating to another location. But that's very situational. But, yeah, Proxy Factory will destroy them. What's up, Powerade Floyd? Because they very, very rarely will put a defensive cannon in their mineral line. And even if they do, your Cyclone can kill that cannon. And even if they get a probe surround and the cannon kills the Cyclone, you're basically guaranteed to kill the cannon as well, and your next Cyclone or your Widow Mine or Hellion or whatever you choose to build next will do big damage to them. So you get a bunker up at home, keep your SCVs repairing it. That just prevents the advance of the cannons. And like I said, you're scouting SCV, so that should be at 17 or 18, depending on how you do it. Heck, if they do a super early cannon rush, like they're sending probes immediately across, as soon as you realize you're being cannon rushed, send an SCV to the other side of the map. Build your proxy factory. Have your bunker at home just to buy you time. Once you get that that Cyclone out, the game should swing in your favor. It's been a long time. I very, very rarely lose to a cannon rush.
Bad news.
Yeah, scout at 17. You'll be safe.
SCV ready.
Not enough minerals. Not enough minerals.
SCV ready. Going. What's going on?
Additional supply depots. Not enough minerals. Not enough minerals. Not enough minerals.
SCV ready.
Yeah, no problem. If I have time tonight, I can actually look through my replays and find... I know for a fact I have replays saved where I played against the Cannon Rush. Not sure I'll have time to go over it tonight, but if I don't go over it tonight, the next time you stop by my stream, remind me, and I will definitely find one of those replays.
Go ahead. I'm going. We hear you.
Not enough minerals.
Huh?
Not enough minerals. Command center upgrade complete. Not enough minerals. Not enough. Our SCV insufficient are under attack. Insufficient Bespin gas. Not enough minerals.
Bad news.
Not enough minerals. Not enough minerals. Not enough minerals.
Big job. Bad news. SCV ready. What? I'm listening. Got something.
Insufficient Bespin gas.
I'm listening. Go. SCV ready. Where?
Oh, shoot. That was like the worst time ever to look at chat.
Complete.
Worst time ever to look at chat, jeez.
Big job, huh? SCV ready.
Not enough minerals. Not enough minerals. Not enough minerals. Not enough minerals.
SCV ready.
Not enough minerals. Not enough minerals.
SCV ready. SCV ready.
Not enough minerals. Not enough minerals.
Not SCV ready.
Not enough minerals. Not enough minerals. Not enough minerals. Additional supply depots required.
Gangway.
I'm in a heap.
Additional supply depots. Not enough minerals.
By the number. Go ahead. In the rear with the...
Ready to plunder.
Not enough minerals. Not enough minerals.
SCV ready.
Not enough minerals. Not enough minerals. Not enough minerals. Not enough
SCV ready.
Not enough minerals. Not enough minerals.
Huh?
Not enough minerals. Command center upgrade complete.
10-4.
SCV ready.
This better be good.
SCV ready.
Not enough minerals.
Let's get
it. SCV
Mission be ready. Let's go.
Not. Minerals.
Yes, sir. Big job.
Not enough minerals.
Armed and ready.
Not enough minerals. Not enough minerals. Not enough minerals. Not enough minerals. Not enough minerals.
By the number one, so.
Not enough minerals.
SCB ready.
Add-on complete. Not enough minerals. Not enough minerals.
Go, go, go!
Ready for dust-off.
Not enough.
This better be good.
Not enough minerals. Not enough minerals. Research upgrade complete. Not enough minerals.
What's so?
In the pipe. Bye-bye-bye.
SCB ready.
Not enough minerals. Not enough.
This better be good. SCB ready.
What a prank show!
Not enough minerals.
What's up, bruh?
Not enough minerals.
We could use some help.
Not enough minerals. Not enough
minerals.
Not enough minerals. Research complete. Additional supply depots required. Not enough minerals.
Where's the emergency?
Go ahead.
Ready for dust off. Somebody, get me out of this mess.
I can't build here. SCB ready.
Not enough minerals.
We are almost 10 minutes in and Jiggy has not doom dropped me yet. I wonder if something's wrong with him right now. Cannot believe this.
Not enough minerals. Not enough minerals. Upgrade.
Gangway, coming through. We could use some help here. You want a piece of me, boy? Go, go, go! Gangway.
Mineral field depleted.
Go, go, go!
Add-on complete.
This better be good. Armed and ready.
Not enough minerals.
Ready for dust off.
What's up? That's fine.
Go, go, go!
Not enough minerals.
Go ahead.
What?
Coming through.
What on earth?
In the rear.
How did that happen?
You could have been waiting on you. You want a piece of me, boy?
Moving into position.
Ready to roll out!
Not enough minerals.
Go, go, go!
Not ready for dust off.
This I can't build here.
Upgrade. Not enough minerals. Not enough minerals.
Gangway, coming through.
Mineral field depleted.
This better be good, boys. You gonna get
armed and ready.
Not enough minerals.
Ready to roll out!
Acceptable landing zone. Not enough minerals. 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 Base is under attack. Not enough minerals. Not enough minerals. Not enough.
Ready to blow.
Upgrade complete. Not enough. Not enough. Not enough minerals. Not enough minerals.
Let's get armed.
Mineral field.
Go, go, go!
Mineral field. Not enough minerals. Not enough minerals. Not enough minerals.
Gangway, coming through.
Not enough energy.
Reporting for action.
Go, go, go!
Not enough energy.
You want a piece of me, boy? This better be good.
Unacceptable landing zone.
Gangway, coming through.
Not enough minerals. Their steam geyser exhausted.
Who wants some?
Get hold of them all.
Not enough minerals. Not enough minerals.
What's going on?
Go, go, go!
Unacceptable.
Who wants some?
Unacceptable. Reporting for action.
Unacceptable.
SCV ready. You want a piece of me, boy?
Add-on complete. Add-on complete. Not enough energy. Not enough energy. Mineral field depleted. Not enough energy. Base is under attack.
Coming through.
Mineral field depleted. Mineral field depleted.
SCV.
Not enough.
Go!
Not enough minerals. Not enough minerals.
All hands to battle stations.
Not enough. Not enough. Additional supply depots required. Not enough.
This better be good.
Additional supply depots. Not enough minerals. Not enough energy. Not enough minerals.
That's a negatory. It's blocked.
Ready.
We could use some help.
Ready.
Want some. Go, go, go!
Upgrade. Mineral field.
This better be.
Best feed. Base is under attack.
Unacceptable command. We are at maximum supply. Unacceptable command. We are at maximum supply.
Something in the way. Go ahead.
Unacceptable command. We are at maximum.
This better be good.
No.
Unacceptable command.
Not enough energy. Upgrade complete. Not enough energy. Our SCVs are under attack. Not enough. Mineral field. Upgrade complete.
Incoming orders.
Not enough minerals.
Go, go, go!
Not enough energy.
Bad news.
This upgrade complete.
I can't build here.
Not enough minerals. Not enough minerals.
Unacceptable command. We are at maximum supply.
Not enough minerals.
Unacceptable command.
Command center upgrade complete.
Unacceptable command. We are at maximum supply. Unacceptable command. We are at maximum supply.
Mineral field depleted. Not enough minerals. Not enough.
I need a scan,
energy.
Man.
Not enough minerals. Not enough energy. Not enough.
Gateway, coming through. Go, go, go! Been waiting on you. By the numbers.
Energy field depleted. SCVs are under attack. Not enough energy.
Gangway, coming through.
Bad news.
Not enough energy. Mineral field.
Go, go, go!
Not enough minerals. Not enough minerals. Not enough minerals. Not enough. Not enough minerals. Not enough
minerals.
Not enough. Not enough.
Who wants some?
Not enough.
SCV ready.
This better be good. Tempo.
Not enough minerals.
Let's see, what did I miss in the chat? How you guys liking the new maps? I'm middle of the road. I think this is the best new map pool that we've had in a while. At the same time, like, I don't think the maps are great. I think we had a lot of really bad map pools in a, or I should say map pools that were okay but had some really bad maps mixed in there. This one, I don't think there's any terrible map. There are some maps I think are really bad for Terran, like one in particular, Cerulean Fall. But I think overall the map pool, it's all right. How about you? Parasite and the Ice One. Yeah, Parasite, I don't know. Like, it's really big. There are a lot of bases to take, but it seems like it's okay. I don't think it's going to be good for me stylistically, but it seems all right. And yeah, Fracture, kind of same thing. I think it's a good map, but it might be a little bit too hectic for me. But again, like, objectively speaking, I don't think there are bad maps. I don't think there are any bad maps in the pool. So, all right, let's see what else I miss in the chat, guys. I actually like the one too. Blue Shift is the one I want. I don't mind Blue Shift. It's, you know, I'm pretty ambivalent on all of the maps in this pool. But compared to other seasons, I think that's fine. Like, Red Shift, I think, is a terrible map. Even though it was good for Terran, I think it was an awful map. Terribly designed. It's come time to back up my PC. All right, man. Good luck with that, Brazil Made Nuts. Let's see. Did I miss anything else? This overlay isn't very Protoss inclusive. What is... I mean, is there a Terran and Zerg in there? D.Va is so annoying. I'm not a big fan of the D.Va announcer either. Hydra Slayer, what is up? I like that name. Sorry for missing you in the chat earlier, but I like that name a lot. As everybody who watches my stream frequently knows, I've got like a personal vendetta against Hydra, so you have my seal of approval, man. Jiggy, now that you're back in Master, man, you need to stream more frequently, bro. Please know Zerg favorite map. You're D1 now? Wait, but you're still Master 3 on EU. Anyway, like, you're playing like a Master 3 anyway. I don't care what your MMR says. I thought your account was Diamond 1 on NA, but Master 3 on EU, isn't it? Hydras need a buff, yeah. And I need a lobotomy. M3 on EU, yeah, that's what I thought. Dude, hey, man, it's not a coincidence. You know, we're both higher on EU than NA. I'm just saying. Like, okay, technically speaking, my highest MMR is like 4820 right now, and it is on NA, but the account that I play more, my main account, is Master 2 on EU, Master 3 on NA. So, just saying, guys, NA confirmed better. I don't know. Why pick a map for the map pool? Let's just play in open space. Probably not ever going to get masters. It depends. I mean, one factor, of course, is how badly you want it and how much you're willing to apply yourself to it. But I'm a firm believer that I do think anyone can get mastered. It's not easy. You know, it's easier for some people than for others, but I really do believe that anyone can get mastered. I don't think anyone can get GM necessarily. Oh, Brogue was Terran. But I really do think that if you apply yourself, if you study, you practice consistently, and you actively seek to improve, you know, not just spamming games, but really trying to learn from them, I do think that you can. I don't play as much and I lose some attacks that I can't rush more. I don't think so, man. It could just be that you hit a plateau. Like, I've definitely hit plateaus. I might even be at a plateau now, to be honest. Like, this low Master 2 area. But when you hit a plateau like that, you have to consciously seek to do something different. I know that sounds like common sense, but I think it's human nature to get stuck in a pattern and to repeat the habits that we have deeply ingrained into us, especially if you have played a lot. On one hand, experience can be very good, but if it's not... if you're not very conscientious about how you're playing and how you're practicing, then it can actually be bad because you'll just be repeating bad habits frequently. So it makes them harder to eradicate later. But some players, okay, I already read. But no, I really do believe though, with the proper mindset and of course practicing, I think playing consistently, but playing consciously, like putting in conscious work, not just grinding out game after game after game after game, but really analyzing your wins and your losses and trying to achieve a deeper understanding of the game, I do believe that you can get to master. I think Grandmaster is it's definitely harder, obviously, but I think that a certain level of talent maybe comes into play, but also I think an extraordinary amount of, you know, if you're less talented, I think an extraordinary amount of like game knowledge, studying and playing has to be, you have to possess that in order to compensate if you're not like a naturally talented player. Let's see. Work and life in general. Yeah. I mean, honestly, that's true. Like, that's a big factor with StarCraft 2. It's technically a game, but, like, let's be realistic. It's the most challenging game. Like, intellectually challenging, I would say mentally and emotionally draining game that exists, as far as I know. It's... the feeling I get when trying to improve in StarCraft is very similar to the feeling I get when trying to improve in chess. Like, chess is also a game, but at the same time, it's proven. You know, both chess and StarCraft enhance your mind. They force you to... If you want to become better at them, you have to stretch your mind. You know, that's why, you know, there are all those studies out there that show, like, for example, StarCraft is proven to help you with... It was crisis management, critical thinking, you know, strategic planning, things of that nature. And chess, of course, is the same, as well as developing spatial intelligence, a number of other forms of intelligence as well. Chess is really good for developing that. But it's like it's work. It's a game, but it's work. So you're totally right about that. I do think it's almost impossible to improve at StarCraft at a certain level while still being casual about it. At some point, you just have to, like, you just have to buckle down. And so whether it's like studying the game more or putting in more games for each person, it's different. But at some point, if you want to get better, you have to, like, it becomes uncomfortable, and it does take a lot of time and or effort and energy. So let's see. Hey, what's up, Giggle Bear? Music is a little loud for this. Oh, seriously? Oh, I'll turn it down a bit. Thank you. Sorry about that. It's kind of weird because, like, for me, in my headphones, the music is really quiet. But I know a couple of people have said it's loud on stream, so I don't know how to, like, properly balance those levels. Hopefully that's better. I did turn it down. But great to see you, Giggle Bear. Always a pleasure, man. Do you guys ever feel that when you win using a certain strat, and when you try to do it in the next game, it's not as successful? So, oh, definitely, for sure. For sure, man. That's a big part of climbing ladder, by the way. I should quit my job and just focus on... That's exactly it, man. That is exactly it. That's the cliff notes right there. Thanks, Vincent. Hey, yeah, absolutely, man. My pleasure, Giggle Bear. But yes, Flipster, that's a really big part of improving, is there are definitely builds. And if if not builds, tactics even, that will work at lower levels on ladder. And when you get into higher levels, even just like a little bit higher, from like, I can say, for example, from Diamond 2 to Diamond 1. So when I got this new account, the one that I'm using just for streaming, and, you know, it placed, you know, I won all 5 placement matches, but it'll automatically put you low. I think it was like, what, Diamond 3 or Diamond 2, something like that. But the difference between a Zerg defending my, a Diamond 2 Zerg defending my 2-1-1, and even just a Diamond 1 Zerg defending my 2-1-1 is very, very big. The Diamond 1 Zergs will defend the 2-1-1 much, much better. Diamond 2 Zergs can just outright lose to it. So, you know, with that being said, there might be a build for you that works well now. You have it down now, but the same tactic might not. So let's say if it's a build that relies on, let's do something like a multi-pronged harassment build, like, you know, like a marine mine drop in the main with a 2 Hellion run by, which is a common build in TVP, at the natural. At a certain level, you can just win the game outright with the initial drop harassment. But if you play against that, let's say it, like, you know, in Diamond League, if it's executed well, you can definitely just win outright. If you get up into master, mid master, definitely high master, you're pretty much never going to win a game with that, with the initial attack. It's all about just getting little edges and then building on those edges throughout the game. It's very, very rare to win the game outright with a harassment-based build like that. So that's just a normal part of climbing up the ladder. So what you have to do, like what your assignment is, if you want to improve, is to look for ways that you can improve on little, you know, on fine, fine-tune specific aspects of your gameplay, whether it's build order, whether it's decision-making, macro, you know, there's so many aspects to the game to improve, but you have to consciously identify where you're lacking and then work to improve them. Probably a lot of this is common sense, but I think it helps to be reminded, I guess. Upper leagues always say focus on macro, but at what point should I, on, like, to, okay, to be perfectly honest, obviously, like, there's definitely truth to that. Macro is extremely important, and it's like pretty much everyone except for the highest level pros in almost every game, at a certain point their macro will slip up a little bit. So, like, it's definitely true. So what I'm saying is you can always try to improve your macro. And unless you're Innovation, who I think has, like, the closest thing to perfect macro of any player in StarCraft 2, unless you're Innovation, you can probably look at any one of your games and pinpoint one little thing that you did wrong. If you even watch, like, you know, a GSL, you'll see the players will get supply blocked every now and then. It's not common, and it's not for a long period of time, but it happens. sometimes. So I just think that's like, so I was going to say, like, to be perfectly honest, I think it's kind of a lazy response. It's true, but it's not very helpful. Like, work on your macro, improve your macro. Okay, cool. It doesn't help very much. I do think that improvement, once you reach a certain level, I would say as a general rule, probably around platinum 1, diamond 3 sort of range, the game becomes a lot more serious. Like, it becomes, there aren't too many, like, strictly casual diamond players. You know, people who play, like, a couple of games a week and have never put a lot of time into the game. When you're in that diamond range, you know, a lot of the players they've played the game for a while, or they play a lot of games, or they watch a lot of StarCraft. You know, they tend to be more, they tend to put more time into the game. And so, you know, yeah, of course, you can definitely improve your macro, but I do think that that improvement becomes more player specific at that point. So meaning, for you specifically, your weakness might be, maybe you're not good at taking engagements. By the way, this was a really big problem for me for a long time. I just wouldn't have a good sense of which engagements I could win and which engagements I would lose. So I would be really aggressive and end up attacking in scenarios where, like, either I didn't have to attack, or it was, like, pretty clear that I wasn't going to win the attack, but I just didn't have the proper game sense to realize that. So I would just die through being too aggressive. So, like, that was my big problem. Wasn't so much macro, wasn't so much micro, more multitasking. I would take really bad engagements. I would be over aggressive and overextend all the time. I still do that sometimes. So that was my thing. But so, by the way, if you ever want, granted, I'm only a Master 2 player, so, you know, I'm not at the highest level of this game, but if you ever want, just send me replays. I'll be more than happy to analyze them, and we can try to pick out things that you specifically can improve on. So, long story short, yeah, you can always improve your macro. Always go back and look at your replays. How long was I supply blocked? Am I missing SCV production cycles? Am I missing army production cycles? You can always look at that, and you'll probably find something wrong. But like I said, I do believe that it goes deeper than that, even at, you know, so-called lower levels. Like, even platinum is already, you're above average as a platinum player in a one versus one game that has almost 300,000 people on the one versus one ladder. So, like, if you're in platinum, no matter what people say, you're a pretty decent player. It's the most competitive one versus one game in the world. But yeah, so I do believe that it goes a lot deeper than just, you know, improve your macro. So, let's see, what have I missed in the chat? I think people sometimes confuse just macro with really, really refine your build. True. Even with the two base all-in, not technically macro, you can work from a very, very good point. That's an excellent point. So, like, by the way, sort of along those same lines, if you can execute one build per matchup very well, as Giggle Bear said, whether it's an all-in or even if it's some sort of like free command center opening into just a pure macro play, if you can nail the build order really well, no matter what is thrown at you, that's the key point. No matter what your opponent is doing, oh my goodness, how many SCVs does he have? Yeah, that's why. I think he's giving away too many, by the way. I do not think he should give away this many. But if you can do that, that will help you a ton. Biomine is not going to be good against this either. I guess it depends on how many. I mean, there are only 14 Hydras. It's not like a huge amount. More Lings are incoming. Maybe it could work. If you look instead of just macro better, it should be just your build cleaner. Yeah, that's a really, really good point. I agree with that. Cool enough. Thanks, man. I appreciate it. Like I said, I really do mean it. If you would like any replays to be analyzed, feel free to send them to me. Like, if there's a, it's usually more useful to analyze losses than wins. Sometimes there are things you can look at in wins and still analyze and benefit from it. But usually, when you lose, there's more to learn. But yeah, anytime you want to send me a replay, just feel free to do so. It's fun for me. I'm a very analytical person in everything that I do, whether it's boxing, StarCraft, chess. So I help, my job is, requires a lot of analysis of policy. So, you know, it's something that I enjoy doing. So feel free to do so, please. Let's see. This engagement is massive. Yeah. What about reading opponent strats? One is, that's sort of, that I think comes down a bit more to your personal style. Like, some players are more reactive. Okay, it's a perfect example of the opposite of that. Innovation basically doesn't change his build for anything. He picks his build and he's going with it. Poult was also that way. Poult would have one build, his opponent would know what he's doing, he would just do it, period, no matter what. So I guess what I'm saying is you can get away with not reading your opponent's build too much. Obviously, if Innovation is going for like a fast third command center build and he scouts a Roach all in, he has to make some kind of adjustment. But what I'm saying is, for the most part, aside from those extreme cases where you're facing an all in or something like that, certain players don't read too much into what their opponent is doing at all, and they focus very much on what they are doing. They focus on their own, on executing their own game plan. Other players are extremely reactive, so I do think that comes down more to your personal preference. I also think that Zerg, for example, is better at being reactive. Terran is not a very good reactive race at all because of how rigid the production mechanics are. You constantly have to be producing units. So it's like, whether you like it or not, you have to be pressing buttons to create units, and if you don't, you're gonna die. So it's, you know, it's hard for Terran to respond reactively. Generally speaking, took up the, yeah, that was what happened to Poult. Yeah, Poult went to the army. Yeah, army. Oh yeah, Powerhead Floyd got. Yeah, that's right. Yeah, I liked Poult a lot. Seems like a really nice guy. His stream was very, very insightful as well. Should I pick what kind of type of play? Honestly, I think that's a good idea, but like, you kind of you'll pick your build based on what you want to do. Yeah, Poult was awesome. I really liked him. So okay, for an example, to use an analogy, like with my fighters at the gym, what I like to ask them is like, if you could do whatever you wanted, like in the ring right now. Like, how would you fight? What would you do? You know, ignore anything that your opponent is doing or could do to you. What would you like to do? Where do you feel comfortable? So, like, me, for example, as a boxer, like, I've got, like, a natural aggression, but at the same time, if I had it my way, I would stay on the outside. I would fight behind my jab, use movement, a lot of footwork, angles, and I'll box the guy. So, like, that's my style. Now, I learn to fight other styles, but my preference is to be like a technical, I would say a technical boxer. I try to use different like feints or different baits to get my opponent to do something that I want and then exploit it. That's my style. But other people in the gym, for example, are aggressive. They want to, like, you know, get in your face. They want to get on the inside, maybe get you up against the ropes. That's what they like. So to translate that to StarCraft, I would ask, like, what do you like to do? Do you like to have, or would you like to have, like, three different small armies on the map just pulling your opponent apart, attacking him here, here, and here at the same time? Is that what you would like? Or would you like, you know, more like an Innovation style to get, like, to get your engine running, your macro engine running, have, you know, like, four Hellions out there keeping an eye on your opponent, but you're just gearing up for one massive push when your upgrade's complete. So I think you have to, like, answer for yourself what's enjoyable for you. Where do you feel most comfortable? From there, then you can choose builds that play to that style. I'm the aggressive no macro guy. Jiggy is a very aggressive player. But actually, your macro now is a lot better than it was even a month ago. Like, you were just straight up kind of like not building your fourth base sometimes. Your macro's a lot better now. Yeah, definitely. I'm in my second fight, for example, it was it was more of an ugly fight because my opponent was just backing up the whole time and he was looking to throw a check hook. So he was just looking to counter me. I could take that two ways. I can stay on the outside and try to box with him. And like I get off and then he counters and then I try to counter off of his counter, right? That's one way to go about it. The other way to go about it and the way that I went about it in the fight was to make it uglier. I'd like to be on the outside. I'd like to box with you. But if you only want to do one thing, you only want to stay back, you would keep leaning back like this and trying to counter. If you're only doing that, to me, that tells me like maybe you're uncomfortable if you're under pressure. So in that fight, I pressed forward a lot. I was aggressive, move forward, throwing a lot of punches, and it was successful for me. So I like to be able to have different styles. I think it's probably the same in StarCraft. I think I use different builds. But I have my preference. So again, you know, for you, it's like find out, you know, ask yourself, like what do I really enjoy doing? Like I said, pulling a guy apart from a million different angles with your multitasking, going for like a one front push, you know, like hell, I mean, you've got you got players like Avalo who like to just sit back and let people attack into them. And you just, you know, you're like a steel curtain. You just let wave after wave of attack come and you just defend it. And when your opponent is exasperated, then you push across and kill him. There are chess players like that, by the way, too. Anatoly Karpov is probably Anatoly Karpov and Tigran Petrosyan. I would say those two are probably the chess equivalents of that. Much better than Avalo, obviously, but very defensive, positional style, and just like slowly, move by move, it's like keep taking the air away from the opponent, keep taking space on the board, make it so he doesn't have any good moves. They don't really attack; they just take your options away from you until you eventually make a mistake. So, speaking about, yeah, I did hear he's back. I don't follow his stream, but I did hear that he's back. Need to get plat 1 minute before the end of the Plat to diamond was hard back then. It was hard for me, I can tell you that. There we go. Thank Frame Show steps in with that clutch clip. But also, as a recommendation for getting better, Flipster, I would say practice. Find a practice partner that is, let's say, 1 to 2 tiers above you. I don't recall what league you're in, but let's say if you're Diamond 3, find a practice partner who's Diamond 2. No better than Diamond 1, I would say. But someone who's just like a little bit better than you. That will also help you raise your game. Again, same concept that I'll apply in boxing for myself and for my fighters, will always spar up. It will make you raise your game. If you go against someone who's way better than you, you just end up getting destroyed and you don't learn much. You get really frustrated. But someone who's just a little bit better than you, and practice with them consistently. Diamond 3. Okay, yeah, perfect then. So you find someone who's Diamond 2. I mean, there are guys on my stream who watch my stream who are Diamond 2. They'd be perfect practice partners. So if you want to get in on one of our peep mode sessions sometimes, that'd be a really good idea. Floyd, for me, fixing my engagements, and again, my engagements are far from perfect now, but they were really bad before. That took me a while. It definitely took at least a few months. That was the biggest factor that held me back from getting master the first time. Almost better, sir. Too much of your playing time on the screen. No, Flipster, that's why I'm here, man. Like this isn't my job. I don't do it for money or anything like that. So for me, the reason why I stream is to engage with viewers. Otherwise, I could just sit here by myself and grind away at games, you know. But I really enjoy Dream Snatcher. I really enjoy engaging with viewers, and especially if I can help. you know, I would love to do that, because there are players who help me a lot. Like Gamer Richie is one. When he stops by my stream, and he's, you know, he's hopped onto Skype and given me a lot of advice, and he does a great job of explaining things. Other players, you know, like QXC is another one. So, you know, they're pretty far above me. If I can help someone out with the knowledge that I've learned from them, I would love to do that. So it's a pleasure for me, man. I lose game with 50 supply ahead. Hey, I used to do that all the time in TBP, so you're not alone there. Funny, oh yeah, that Avalo clip. Oh my goodness, man. Frameshow's not gonna let me forget that one. Love to get Diamond 2 by next month. Yeah, Rich is great indeed. He's an awesome, awesome streamer. Great personality, great guy. He's helped me a ton. He's got an awesome attitude, and he's really good at teaching as well. Really good at breaking things down. Also, like QXC is also a fantastic analytical thinker and teacher. Actually, he moved out to San Francisco last summer, but he lived here in my city, in Pittsburgh. So we actually hung out a few times, and he had me like test play his board games that he was creating. It was really cool. Really cool to like hear him, how he thought about his games and how he was designing them too. And then, of course, you know, he gave me a few StarCraft 2 lessons, which were awesome. They were very, very helpful. Like I said, he was an excellent teacher. For me, I like when people can explain why you do something, not just do this at that time, then do this. And that, to me, that doesn't engage my mind. In order to properly teach someone, no matter what the activity is, whether it's StarCraft, boxing, piano, chess, anything, I think the best way to teach someone is first you have to teach them how to learn, you know, how to use their mind. And in order to do that, you have to get them to understand why things occur the way they do, or why they need to do something a certain way. Jiggy with his ultra safe expansion on the high ground. But yeah, man, Flipster, I really do think that you could get Diamond 2 for sure. You know, just keep those things in mind about make sure, don't ever mindlessly play. I think that's probably number one. You know, you don't want to overthink things while you're playing, of course, but you know, try to play with a purpose. So, you know, like, don't just grind out games on ladder just to get some games in. Try to think to yourself, okay, like, what do I need to do in this matchup? What are my objectives for this game? And, you know, try to remind yourself of those things throughout the game, and I feel you'll make smarter decisions. You'll be more aware of why you're doing what you're doing in game, rather than just sort of playing from muscle memory. And when you do that, like I was saying before, you can end up just repeating bad habits. But hope that helps, man. Alright, so we do have 2-1-1 here, by the way. 2-1-1, or, you know, I'm assuming there will be another one, that being the Starport, once this finishes up. There's actually a double Reaper opener. I think that's because Brogue, if I'm not mistaken, Brogue did go pool first. So, pretty sure that's why we see the, or why we saw the second Reaper here. And still no third base for Brogue, so somewhat late, as a matter of fact. Scan, unfortunately for Jiggy, doesn't really reveal anything. I guess it did reveal a round of drones. I think there were two drones that were sent down there, so it's kind of comforting. It's essentially verification that you're not going to be all-in at the moment. But aside from that, doesn't really tell you all that much. Believe in everybody but you? Yeah, right, man. What are you talking about? I'm the one who was sitting here telling you that you're going to be GM. Get out of here with that. Get out of here with that nonsense. And the reason why I say that to you, by the way, Frame Show, is because of how quickly you improved. I saw a similar tendency with Scars. He's on vacation right now in Spain. He goes there every summer. But I saw how quickly he improved, like made huge progress in a very short period of time. And to me, it was obvious that he would get, like, even when he was Master 3, it was obvious that he would get to GM because of how quickly things were like catching on and clicking with him. But yeah, I think that you definitely can and will get GM. I don't, you know, I can't really say when, obviously, but you will get it. If you choose to stick with the game, that is. Let's see. Love me, Dad. It's true. Dad's like other kids other than their own. Because they're shitheads sometimes. Oh, man. Frame show play toss, easy peasy. Yeah, he doesn't now, but... Wait, what? Okay, bad rally. Yeah, he doesn't now, but if he makes that switch, who knows, man. Well, this is going to be unwelcome news for Bro. Oh my good. Oh my goodness. He sent three more over there too. So he just donated two drones. I know he's pissed about that right now. He donated two drones and then four more, were ready to die for the cause before finally turning around. This dude is just going to chill here, apparently. Supposed to game with Brogue on Saturday, by the way. I think we're going to play at his house, though. If we play here, then I'll stream it as I usually do. I think I'm going to be playing at his house. In which case, we'll probably play like Mario Tennis. Because I can't bring my PC there. But if we play here, it will be streamed, boys. So Bro going with the Roach Ravager approach this time. The Roach approach. Round of 16 drones. You know that was done as a vindicating measure for the two drones that were slaughtered by this bunker. And the four who almost met the same fate. So Bro wanted to get his drones in one way or the other. These Stim Marines might... Okay, no. It took too long running away. I was about to say they might be able to focus down on the Ravagers. He lived close to Broach, I do see. Yeah, well played, sir, well played. Yeah, Broach is, he's my cousin. So, you know, we grew up together. He's my, technically speaking, he's my second cousin. But, yeah, we grew up together, so cousins and best friends, basically. He lives about 20 minutes away from me now. 25 minutes, something like that. So yeah, so he, a lot of times he'll come over here, he'll bring his laptop, he'll set up in the other room over there, and we call it boot camping, so we do our StarCraft boot camp. Just, spam games all day, it's pretty fun. But yeah, so that's why, like, when you see me in a practice session, you know, a lot of times I'm practicing with Brogue, it's, you know, it's 'cause he's my cousin, so. We got into StarCraft at exactly the same time, and from the beginning we've been, you know, going at it, helping each other improve. He started out as a Protoss player, little known fact. It was only for maybe a month. It's probably might have even been less than that. He tried Terran for a very, very short time and then switched to Zerg. I've been a Terran from the start. From the very start, I'll say that. Just gripped my heart and never let it go. I don't know anyone in person to play. Beef, what's up, son? How you doing, man? Good to see you. I don't know anyone in person to play SC2. I tried to get my nephew, but it wasn't for him. It's a tough game to get people into. Like, especially if they're, you know, like more... I don't want to say just like casual gamers, but if they don't have... It's a very specific person that this game... appeals to. It's people like, I think it's people who are, you know, like intense and competitive, and specifically in one versus one. You know, people can be competitive, but they enjoy team sports more, working together. You know, StarCraft players are a rare breed, and it also is, as I was saying before, it is an intellectually challenging game. You know, there are a lot of mechanics involved, physical aspects to the game. but there's a lot of thought. And you know, for a lot of people, that thought aspect becomes like work, because it kind of is. I think Jiggy has done it here, by the way. It's a very well-timed attack. This Ling run by, it would have been really strong if it happened maybe like a minute ago. If it would have happened while Jiggy's army was, let's say, like here, it would have done fantastic damage. I mean, even as it is, it's still doing decent damage, but if you take a look at the army supply, it's not really where Brogue would like to be. Jiggy is returning home. I mean, he killed the fourth base. Brogue still has three bases. I don't think he has an infestation pit. Does he have an infestation pit? No. So there aren't going to be any tech transitions anytime soon. So what that means for Brogue is there isn't really any light at the end of the tunnel. He's just going to have to like hold on tight and hope he doesn't die to the next push. Jiggy's economy was hurt by that attack, but not critically so. And as long as he remains on even base with Brogue, he doesn't have to worry too much about anything. Oh, these Banelings are not in the best place to be forced in here. Good priest hits from Jiggy. Yeah, here we go. This is a nice run by from Brogue. It's going to cause a disruption. It'll be cleaned up by Jiggy, which needs to respond to it. This could allow Brogue to swoop in on this army here. There's only one tank with this, actually. That might just be Jiggy's undoing. If he would have had more tanks there, I think he would have dealt with that with relative ease. But yeah, with only one tank there, like Lingbane Hydra does very, very well against bio armies with low tank counts. Now, Brogue absolutely can't push into this. With four tanks here, not to mention the bio, Brogue can't attack that at all. In fact, he shouldn't be looking to attack right now. He was able to repel this attack, and he should be looking to defend and get his economy up. He should not look to press the issue here. He really shouldn't. Let's see. Wait, how many games went to LOM? I'm not sure I understood the question. I'm sorry, Floyd. Or what's your Fortnite? Yeah, please abandon your nephews. I actually have another my college roommate and another guy I knew growing up, like since middle school. He also plays StarCraft. You'll see me play with him every now and then. Bukovetsky. He was like a Diamond 3 Terran. Really, really smart guy. He's getting his doctorate in astrophysics at UCLA. Really cool dude. But yeah, so he and Brogue are my two real life friends who play StarCraft, and I met someone in StarCraft who ended up becoming my friend in real life as well. That was Roy Mustang. He doesn't play much anymore, but every now and then he plays. And then of course, you know, QXC, and you know, met him through StarCraft, and then found out he lived in my city, so we ended up, you know, met him in real life and hung out a number of times before he moved to San Francisco. Had another friend from high school who I found out played StarCraft. We played. He was from my wrestling team, and we did play a few games together. But he mostly played arcade. I think he was a Silver League player in 1v1. He only placed in one season or something. But he pretty much just plays arcade. So I guess I don't really count that. Let's see. Yeah, QXC. I met him through StarCraft, taking lessons with him, and then found out. It was actually a pretty cool story. I went to a barber shop. It's not even the barber shop that I go to now. I couldn't get my usual barber. Desperately needed a haircut. Went to a barber shop. The other guy was wearing. Saw a guy there wearing. I forget if it was a Protoss shirt or if it was just a StarCraft shirt. Yeah, he was wearing a StarCraft-related t-shirt anyway, and I just said to him, you play StarCraft. So do I. Anyway, he told me who he was. Thundertoss. He was actually, I guess, he was playing the game before I ever did, but I think he was a team manager for a couple of pro teams. You can look him up on Liquipedia. But I didn't know the name, but he said, yeah, I was the coach of this team, and I don't think he owned a team, but he managed a team, he coached a team, etc. I think he may have even been a pro himself for a little while. But yeah, so we talked very briefly, and then he mentioned something about he hangs out with QXC frequently here, and I was like, oh, QXC lives here in Pittsburgh, and he's like, yeah. So anyway, the next time I took a lesson with QXC, I was like, oh yeah, it was crazy. I was at the barbershop, and I met someone who's said he's friends with you. It's Thunder Toss. And he's like, oh yeah, no way. And then he asked me, he's like, you live in Pittsburgh? Yeah. So anyway, from there, first time we hung out, he was showing me one of the, two of the board games that he was developing. So he was working on a number of them at the same time. So he wanted to meet up and have someone test out the game that he was playing. So that's what we do. It's really cool. After that, then we hung out a few more times, played a lot of board games together. So a lot of fun. I had never really been into board games before. It's really cool though. But last summer he moved to San Francisco. So kept in touch through a few text messages since then, but kind of sucks. It was really fun hanging out with him. His girlfriend was really nice too. But yeah, she got a job out in San Francisco, so he had to move out there. He's a really cool guy. pretty like sarcastic, dry sense of humor. Very very smart guy. But he's really cool. A really nice guy. Really humble. You would never humble at the same time. You can tell has like confidence. He's really freaking good at games, and he's again a really smart guy. But you wouldn't know that he was a pro gamer. He didn't talk about that too much really. So, but definitely a cool guy. Really nice. Wearing a pro. I wish I could remember the shirt that the guy was wearing. Might have been for some reason I'm thinking it was like an old school shirt, like a Wings of Liberty shirt or something, or it might have been a Protoss shirt. I might be mixing that up because I think he was a Protoss. His name's Thunder Toss. But anyway, it might have been a Wings of Liberty shirt. But anyway, he was wearing a StarCraft related shirt, and that's how we started talking. His girlfriend's really nice too, if you know what. Yeah, exactly. No, she was really cool. So I brought my fiance, went over. I think on two occasions. So, nice, cute little, wasn't really a double date. We just went over to their house to play board games, but it was a lot of fun. I lost actually a lot. I was actually getting pretty frustrated. We played a lot of different games and I was losing like everything. Every game we played, I was losing. So, that was kind of annoying. But besides that, it was a lot of fun. I'm kind of kidding, but I'm kind of serious. I need to get that armor in D2, guys. Send pics or it didn't happen. Pics of what specifically? I think these boys are done here. Jigs, yeah, Jigs with overstimming. Some things never change. I think it was Tupac who said that, right? Yeah, that was the last line of the song Changes. Of his girlfriend being not yet. Frame show. Shame on you, son. Shame on you. I mean, honestly, though, he used to... I think she played StarCraft a bit, actually. Way back in the day, I'm talking like 3-4 years ago, when QXE streamed. He never streamed a lot, but when he did stream, she would sit there and like watch the games and talk about the games with him. So, you know, I bet if you really wanted, you could look up his channel and find his VODs, and you could probably see her for yourself. But like I said, they're both really nice, really cool people. She was really freaking smart too. Both of them were really smart. She told me what she was studying at. She was studying here, and it was really, really complex. It was beyond my understanding. But yeah, they're both very intelligent people. I'm not even gonna comment on that. I can't comment on that one way or the other without getting in trouble. So. But I can tell you what really matters either way is, like I said, they're both awesome people. I don't know if I believe them without pick. Hey, I'm so you're gonna have to take my word for it or not. You know, you can also not believe me, that's fine. But all right, guys, I guess I'm gonna start playing Destiny 2, and I don't think anybody wants to watch me stream that, so that's going to be it for me tonight. I'm going to be playing and streaming tomorrow. Nakamura wants to practice a bit, but I'll play some ladder before that. So be a bit of ladder practice session with Nakamura. So that'll be, two Master 2s going at it. TVZ, if you want to check that out. Probably play a few games. Last time we played like 6 games. So that will be tomorrow. Anyway, guys, time for me to head out. Thanks a lot for watching, guys. I really appreciate it. Oh, come on, your fiance is not her. Yeah, thanks a lot, guys, for watching. I really appreciate it, and I really enjoyed the chat as well. So thanks all of you for showing up, being active in the chat, and I hope to see you guys tomorrow. Have a great night, everyone, and we'll catch you later. Oh yeah, and Flipster, yes, I do play Destiny too. I basically just use it as a way to unwind from playing StarCraft, because StarCraft is really stressful. But yeah, so we can talk about that next stream, next time you see me. If you play Destiny 2, also feel free to add me. It'd be cool to play together. Anyway, have a great night, guys, and I'll catch you tomorrow. GG's.